for Professor Edami Santemiye. We've been sitting for quite a while. I think part of comprehensive healthcare says that it's not healthy for us to sit for such a long time. For those of us that can stand, I'd like you to please join me to stand and smile as you're standing. Please do so. I said smile, not laugh. But if you can give someone a laugh, yes. Very good, very good. Very good, very good. Now, we have an orchestra, the Arts and Medicine Orchestra. They will play, listen, the theme for this year is that the sickle cell disorder is not a what? Is not a what? Now, I understand that so many of us are, we're very extremely serious about life, that we're not having the best of life. So, orchestra, you will play something intellectually stimulating and creatively expressive. I don't want you to dance as much. I just want you to be able to move your body. Joyfully move your body. All right? And while you are moving, just give someone a smile. If there's someone you want to walk up to and tell the person, you look lovely, sir. You look lovely, ma. Do that smiling. Thank you, ma. Thank you, ma. I must walk up to you and give you something. If it's just a smile. Camera. Oh, yeah, now. I'm walking. Oh, yeah. Show me. The song has not started. We're already vibing. So, orchestra, we're ready for you. This is, let the blood flow. All right, while you're doing that, please be smiling. All right? Orchestra, we're ready for you. We're upstanding. We can do it for 2 minutes or three. Some people are already moving. So I'm going to leave here and just move around a little bit myself. Yourselves, please. You can be seated. You can be seated. Thank you so much, Arts and Medicine Orchestra. I know if we had asked you to do Asake, you would have done the orchestra version of. But if you had done Asake, the public lecture would have ended. Because some persons would have forgotten that we are here for her, and they would just... All right. Our next speaker will be speaking on importance of early and accurate diagnosis of sickle cell disorder. She obtained a medical degree at the College of Medicine, University of Lagos, and had residency training in hematology and blood transfusion at the Lagos University Teaching Hospital, earning a fellowship of the National Postgraduate Medical College of Nigeria, FMC PATH. She also obtained a master's degree in hemoglobin pathies at the University of London with a distinction. She joined the world of academia in 2009 with lecturer one position in the Department of Hematology and Blood Transfusion, Faculty of Clinical Sciences, College of Medicine, University of Lagos, and rose to the position of Professor of Hematology in a span of 13 years. She is also, yes, you can clap, please. She is also a consultant specialist hematopathologist to the Lagos University Teaching Hospital, where she held the position of head of department between 2016 to 2018. Her research and clinical interests are in sickle cell disorder, blood transfusion, and inherited bleeding disorders. She has been working in the lead with the Hemoglobin Reference Laboratory and the Muyiwa Talabi EBT Affairs Unit of the Sickle Cell Foundation of Nigeria since 2013 to ensure provision of accurate and reliable diagnosis of hemoglobin pathies, as well as availability of emergency and routine blood exchange procedures for sickle and non-sickle patients. She pioneered the Bleeding Disorder Clinic and the World Bleeding Disorder Registry at the Lagos University Teaching Hospital. She's a member of several university and hospital committees, including the Bone Marrow Transplant Committee, charged with the mandate to set up a joint Sickle Cell Foundation Nigeria /LUT stem cell transplant program for sickle cell disorder and other hematological disorders. She's also a member of the National Working Group on the review of the National Guideline for the Control and Management of Sickle Cell Disorder in Nigeria. She is the principal investigator and co-investigator of several funded ongoing collaborative research in sickle cell disorder, anemia, hemophilia, including an NIH-funded grant, Sickle Gen Africa, Sickle Cell Disorder Genomics Network of Africa, low-dose aspirin for preventing intrauterine growth restriction and preeclampsia in sickle cell pregnancy. Wow. A randomized controlled trial, intravenous versus oral iron for iron deficiency anemia in pregnant and postpartum Nigerian women. Open-labeled randomized controlled trials and assessing combination hydroxyurea and exogenous entropotein in sickle cell disorder. She is also the principal investigator of the Sickle Cell Disorder Registry Nigeria, sponsored by the Sickle Cell Foundation Nigeria, with the objective to collect real-time, multi-center, prospective and longitudinal data of patients with sickle cell disorder to provide local evidence to improve the quality of care of persons living with sickle cell disorder and provide data for advocacy. She has authored and co-authored over 40 publications in both local and international peer-reviewed journals. She's married to the current chief medical director of LUT, and they are blessed with three children, Abib, Abiba, and Amida. Allow me to add this before I introduce her. You already know she is a stickler for punctuality. Make welcome Professor Titilokpe Adeyemo. I appreciate her.
Interesting. All right. So thank you all very much. And thank you for that profile. So before I sit or stand on the existing protocol, please let me acknowledge the high table, particularly my teachers of teachers, Professor Akinyoju, Professor Akinshete. They are our mamas and papas in hematology. Okay. So thank you all for being here and for inviting me our representative of the Federal Ministry of Health, WHO, and my guests from the Lagos University Teaching Hospital. Thank you for giving me permission to be here. So I'm going to talk about the importance. Can I have my slides, please? The importance of early diagnosis and accurate diagnosis of sickle cell disorder. I have no conflict of interest to declare, so, and I'm going to make it simple. Next slide, please. I'm simply going to give some case reports. These are real life narratives, the real life stories of that I have encountered in the course of my practice that speaks to the importance of early diagnosis and accurate diagnosis of the disorder. Next slide, please. Well, this is a case that is very dear to my heart. Every time I remember it, I will always ask myself, what could we have done better? Okay, 5-year-old boy, I was called after the first stroke event because they needed to do an extreme blood transfusion. I'd been having sleep apnea, okay? That means the child stops breathing during sleep, and that makes, of course, the parents to panic and worried. And they sought help, and they were told they were going to have surgery. And they were preparing for the surgery. But the child was not in any sickle care program, okay? They didn't know he had sickle cell disease and was not in any care program. Okay, he's been having some pains and febrile illness now and then, treated for malaria, so-called typhoid, and so on and so forth. But 2 days to the surgery, the child developed a clumsy movement, speech disturbances, hemiparesis, could not move one side of the body, started having seizures and lost consciousness. He was diagnosed to have had a stroke. He was the first of 2 children. It was very devastating to the family. They did not know their genotype, but in the course of evaluating this child who presented with stroke, the child was identified to have hemoglobinosis, and both parents had AS. The child never recovered and remained in a vegetative state. As at the last time I had contact with them, we were still trying to get them help. They were quite helpless. I had visit with the neurologist, visit this, and looking for the child just did not recover. And it was very devastating because the parents would have done better if they had known, okay, that their child had SS and they were both AC. The child had a stroke, and the risk for stroke is enormous in sickle cell disease, sickle cell disorder. The stroke risk increases 100-fold when the child has sickle cell disorder compared to children who do not have sickle cell disorder. So you can say 100-fold and the risk for stroke. 11% of patients who have sickle cell disorder would have clinically apparent stroke, overt stroke, before the age of 20. That means 1 in 10. That is how high the risk is. And the risk is highest during the first decade. It peaks between the age of 2 and 5. Okay, so between the age of 2 and 5, there is a 1 in 10 chance that a child is likely to come down with stroke. That is why we need to know. We need to know those children who are sickle cell, and then among the children who have sickle cell, who are those who have the high risk for stroke, so that we can put in an intervention. It's even worse with silent stroke. 40% of children by the age of 18 will have one. Okay, when you start to, and we do see them in the clinics, when they come to you and say, he's just not doing well in class, he's just slow, he's just, a lot of it have to do with them missing schools because of vaso-occlusive pains and crisis and so on. But a lot of it also is something they cannot help because of the several cerebral infarcts that they've suffered over the course of their life. I'm an adult physician, so I see them 15 years and above. And then we see those children, the parents are worried, it's just not doing well in school, and so on and so forth. And it's going to take me back to what our guests, my teacher, and teacher of my teacher said, the importance of comprehensive sickle cell care. While we work on all the advances, and my my professor too have said it. While we work on all the advances in gene therapy and stem cell transplant and so on, what has really worked was identified in 1978 when the American government, the US government, set up the National Sickle Cell Heart and put in place comprehensive care for sickle cell disease. That is what has been clear to have made significant and profound difference than what we are having in the last 10 years with all the recent advances. Next slide, please. And as I said, why do we need to know? It's because when you know, you can put in an intervention. With the annual stroke screening, which has been established with the Sickle Cell Foundation, and I think that is about the only site in Lagos, okay, that is offering this service, and we're definitely going to need more if we want to have comprehensive treatment centers around. With the sickle stroke screen, a child with sickle cell would be identified to be high risk or normal risk, and if it's high risk, this child can have care. But unfortunately, only a very small fraction of children are screened. If the stroke screen detects problem, of course, intervention like monthly blood transfusion or the use of hydroxyurea can be put in place, and that significantly reduces the risk for the stroke. Next slide, please. Second case, this one also is very painful to me because it was a lot of series of missed opportunities. I met AA, that was in the peak of the COVID strike, 2020. Okay, she was in Lagos to serve at Henwa Hesi, and then developed severe anemia, poor appetite, she was just sick. Several hospitals, typhoid and malaria. Several treatments for typhoid and malaria. Eventually, she was referred for the anemia that they can't explain. And then we screened as part of our routine baseline workup. She had a basic metabolic panel that showed the urea and creatinine out of the sky. This is CKD. What is happening in a 24-year-old youth copper? So as part of our screening for what is anemia, we got to know that she has sickle cell anemia. She had never been diagnosed prior. And it calls to question, how could a youth copper not been diagnosed before now? Why it is a series of missed opportunities? We have what we call the preschool screening. People are sent to go and do tests, including genotype, as part of their preschool workup. But we miss that opportunity because I do say it. People will come to you and say, please, it's too much wahala. Just give me the medical reports. If they don't come to me, they will go to any of the primary health care centers or general hospitals and just pay somebody 50 naira or 200 naira and get a report and miss the opportunity to be screened. She missed that screening. Pre-employment, we also have those opportunities. For most people who are going to go into formal employment, you're going to be asked to go and do some form of pre-employment medical evaluation. It's also an opportunity to screen. Somehow it's been mixed. And a lot of people do miss these things. And then, by the time they are being picked up to have sickle cell disorder, they already have a lot of endogenic damage that are irreversible. So she required dialysis, and we had to put her on dialysis program. And then unfortunately, she passed away within 12 months of this diagnosis. Already we know that even once they are on dialysis, when they present with sickle nephropathy and they're on dialysis, the mean time to death is it's just about 4 years, okay? So we need to prevent them from getting to that level. The evidence of kidney dysfunction in sickle cell disease is as early as the 9th to 18th month of life. For those of us that are familiar with the baby hug trial, okay, part of the study design was to look at kidney and splenic function, okay, in these children as they are being treated with hydroxyurea. So as early as 8th to 9th, ninth month of life, the kidney dysfunction has already set in. Without intervention, this is going to progress. And usually, by the second to third decade of life, they are progressing to end-stage kidney disease. And remember what I said. Once they're in end-stage kidney disease, they have to go on dialysis. The mean time to death is a maximum of about 4 years. Okay? And it is common. 5 5% to 18% of patients with sickle cell disease will develop an end-stage kidney disease if you do not intervene. You cannot intervene if you do not know. Okay? You can't not start to screen for kidney dysfunction if you do not know an individual has sickle cell disease. And it also calls to importance again, the importance of comprehensive sickle cell disease management. That is all what it takes. Okay, you are in a care program. Somebody sees you at intervals. Your kidney function, heart function, these things are tested. And interventions are put in place as soon as a dysfunction is noticed before they progress to end stage and irreversible damage. Okay? Chronic kidney disease, as I said, quite common. One in five, if they are not treated, if they are not in a care program, if they do not receive comprehensive care, they are going to develop, almost one in five, it's going to develop sickle nephropathy. And that reduces the lifespan significantly by as much as 25 to 30 years. Next slide, please. So, associated factors, I'm just using sickle nephropathy as an example. That's kidney disease associated with sickle cell. That is just an example because that is what we see. We see a lot of it in the clinic. I'm an adult physician, as I said, and a lot of people are presenting, okay, to our clinic for the first time for sickle cell care. If you ask the history, where have you been getting sickle cell care in your childhood? Never. I've never had care. I only go to the hospital to get treated for typhoid and malaria. Please, sickle cell disease is not typhoid and malaria. It can be treated as typhoid and malaria. It's a lifelong condition. They have to receive lifelong comprehensive care. They must be in a care program. Because for most of these chronic end organ disease or dysfunction, we know they have associated and protective factors. We know what is likely to accelerate the condition. And we know what is likely to protect. And I've highlighted a few of them. Recurrent acute stress syndrome is known to be a significant risk factor for progression, okay, of the early kidney dysfunction we see in childhood to end-stage kidney disease. Many vaso-occlusive episodes. Very severe anemia, hemoglobin of 5 grams, hemoglobin of 6 grams. It's not something that we should ignore because there are risk factors for accelerating the progression of organ complication, not just the kidneys. And we know a protective factor is high fetal hemoglobin. For all these factors that I've listed, both risk factors and associated factors, we know hydroxyurea make a lot of difference. Hydroxyurea will reduce recurrent acute chest syndrome. Hydroxyurea will reduce frequency of vaso-occlusive episodes. Hydroxyurea will improve hemoglobin level. If somebody is well monitored and on hydroxyurea, hemoglobin would at least, if you don't use what we call the maximum tolerated dose, hemoglobin will probably peak at about 9 grams, 8.8 grams, 9 grams, 10 grams, which is much better than having hemoglobin of 6.5 grams, which is a risk factor for organ damage. Okay? And how do you acquire high fetal hemoglobin? Hydroxyurea, that is the basic mechanism of action. If somebody is in a care program, sickle cell comprehensive care program, that person is likely to receive hydroxyurea. And that drastically reduces the risk for many of the organ complication and organ dysfunction that we see in people with sickle cell as they grow older. Next slide, please. Okay, so these two cases highlight the importance of early diagnosis. It shows the dire consequences of not being diagnosed. And it highlights the mixed opportunities you have for screening. I said it before, preschool screening, pre-employment screening, pre-marital screening. Even if the couples are both AS, at least they make the informed decision, okay, to go into that union. And they can plan for whatever is going to come their way. Community screening. I know, for example, the foundation organizes a lot of community outreaches. These are all opportunities for people to get screened, to be identified, and to be put in the care program. And then I have also put it for emphasis there, the newborn and infant screening program. And thankfully, the government of the Federal Republic of Nigeria is making a lot of efforts towards this. Okay, there is a national newborn policy. I don't know if it's been launched, but at least it's being put in place. And we hope that with time, with prayers, and with all our commitment, okay, we are going to see this being being rolled out. A slide before this, please. Inaccurate diagnosis, okay, misdiagnosis. And this is also an experience that I would like to share, because these are both educated doctors and doctor misses. Okay, they knew their genotype, or they thought they knew their genotype. Okay, Dr. Mister knew, thought he was AA, and when he met Dr. Mrs. said, "Well, I'm AS. Before we can take this further, please get your genotype done." And he went back to get his genotype done, and he was given again AA. And I'm not going to say which hospital. Okay, this happened. But he went to a supposedly high level hospital to have his genotype done, and he was told again that he was AA. And then they went ahead with the union. And then their first child, from about the age of 2-3, started having unexplained anemia, frequent febrile illness, and hospitalization. Okay, during the course of this, they had a second child. But eventually, the first child was diagnosed by around her fourth birthday to be hemoglobin SS. Of course, they were shocked. How could this have happened? Okay? And the second child too was tested, also had HBSS. Of course, this was shocking and devastating to this young family. And that was because Mr., on re-evaluation, was he is hemoglobin AS. And several labs, at least two or three labs, okay, have missed for whatever reason. How the mistake could have happened, as misdiagnosed him as AA. Next slide, please. So the implication of genotype misidentification is very rampant. Okay, recently, a couple of weeks ago, I had a young man come to my clinic. He's been having priapism. And you will have thought that with priapism, somebody will say, okay, no, this must be... Of course, somebody still thought about this must be sickle cell. Go have your genotype. But unfortunately, some laboratory were giving them AS. And they were very perplexed. How could this? Hemoglobin W cell count was normal. So this wasn't a leukemia. Okay, eventually, he was eventually diagnosed. After he has suffered a lot of priapism, was not appropriately treated because he had sickle cell, and eventually developed erectile dysfunction before he was eventually diagnosed to have SS. Okay? It's very rampant. It's disheartening, but it's very rampant. Consequence of lack of standard and quality controls in most of our clinical laboratories. A lot of our labs are doing what we call the genotype tests without using controls. You cannot do genotype tests without using controls. And you cannot issue laboratory results for genotype using only one single test. At a minimum, you must do two tests. You must combine sickle solubility or sickling tests with your genotype, okay, to be sure that, yes, this is SS. Okay, and not just look at, oh, you have a band here, and this band will be AA. Because SS people are usually, because it's one single band that they see on electrophoresis, and without controls, okay, there, misinterpret the single band, okay, to be AA. Of course, it causes a lot of financial and emotional issues. Are involved in parenting a child with significant lifelong disease or disability just because some laboratory made an error, especially for people who really want to make informed decision. Okay, it does not call into question that they do not love or have devotions for their child. It's just that it is their right to make that decision. And that decision should not be imposed, okay, by a wrong diagnosis. Next slide, please. Okay, so I'm going to wrap up. I'm sure my 20 minutes is almost over. I'm going to wrap up by just giving some recommendation. We must use, already there are existing opportunities to screen and identify sickle cell disorder. We must use all these opportunities. Preschool, pre-employment, pre-marital, community outreaches, they are there. Let us use these opportunities. And then, of course, we hope that soon the federal government is going to roll out the newborn screening program so that people are even identified within the first few weeks of life. Okay, so we will continue to advocate for the National Universal Newborn Screening Program. And then for the laboratories, the regulatory bodies, and I'm happy that the Medical Laboratory Science Council of Nigeria are going to be on top of this. Regulatory bodies must ensure that laboratories making diagnosis for sickle cell disorder are taking all steps to eliminate or minimize systematic errors that can occur, that their instruments are routinely calibrated, that they are using controls, they are maintaining the instruments and equipment, and they are comparing values against standards, and are training and retraining their staff to be able to make accurate diagnoses of sickle cell disorder. Next slide, and I think that's going to be the last. Okay, so the take-home message: people living with sickle cell disease can live full lives, they can enjoy most of the activities that other people do, but to achieve this, it is important for them to learn how to live as healthy as possible. The opportunity to learn how to live as healthy as possible starts with early and accurate diagnosis of the disorder, and then followed by being enrolled in a comprehensive sickle cell disorder program. And I'm happy that our guest of honor has emphasized that Sickle Cell Foundation will have to take the lead in getting these things being established, the comprehensive sickle cell disease programs in our country. So thank you all very much for your attention.
Please celebrate Professor Titilokpe Adeyemo. In all the interactions I've had with you, ma'am, your punctuality, stickler for timing, has been phenomenal. Please appreciate her. I want to say something very quickly before we take our next speaker. If you're in the hall or you're joining us online, wherever you are in the world, when you go for clinical tests, blood group, genotype, whatever it is, you must query the results you are given. Ask deeper questions. Once upon a time, I had a young lady assist in my family house, and that lab, we used to go to a particular lab, name withheld. Their result was standard. If you bring someone, no matter who the person is, the result is typhoid and malaria. Let the person be whole, very healthy, typhoid and malaria. We took this lady that just came to work with us, and I said, this is the sixth typhoid and malaria test from this lab. Let's go somewhere else. It was discovered that this person had hepatitis and had just given birth. Pregnancy, there was some pregnancy. The first lab didn't capture anything. It was typhoid and malaria. Professor Titilokpe gave us a number of heartbreaking stories. Doctor and Dr. Mrs. Where do they start from? Now, I told you my story. My story has gone well. What if my wife was actually AS and the lab said she's AA? So we need to be... The NYSC is a very good place. Many of us, when we cut corners in the place of our health, there are devastating consequences. So when the NYSC is doing the screening, some persons are pregnant and they insist, we want to serve, we want to do 3 weeks. NYSC says, no, the rigors can cause you to miscarry. They say, no. We need to, this level of awareness must increase. I was speaking with Dr. Mimuna, WHO, and she said they're ready to partner with as many organizations, including Sickle Cell Foundation, to ensure that the clinical trials for hemoglobin test is done in many communities. We do a lot of medical outreaches. We need to include this as part of our medical outreach advocacy. Allow me to switch. It is not helpful. It is not the way to go. and God will help us. We have a warrior in our midst. I'm going to read our profile. We have someone who's going to be speaking to us about surviving and thriving with sickle cell disorder. She's a wellness coach, a social entrepreneur, an author, an artist, and a sickle cell warrior and advocate. She holds a BSc degree in economics from Lagos State University. She's a certified health coach from Institute of Integrative Nutrition, New York, and has a certification in life coach and emotional intelligence. I like this. She's currently the founding executive director of Sickle Cell Advocacy and Management Initiative, SAMI, a non-governmental organization with vision to build a society where sickle cell disorder is reduced and people with sickle cell as well as their families are able to lead healthy, positive, and productive lives. With a non-governmental organization, they have impacted over 4,000 lives and run a monthly free clinic with a membership of over 600 plus. Through a management consulting initiative, Rise Support Consults, she aims to raise people to create change and influence. It aims to help professionals in business and career rise above their hurts, pains, and perceived limitations to navigate the journey of change, find purpose, influence their environment, and live their best life through their stories. She is the host of the radio show, Touch a Cell with Tony and the Gang. She is the author of two books, Still Standing and The Misadventures of Oga and Madame AS. She has won several awards, including UNESCO Runaway Jazz Humanitarian Award, Endo Limited, Unlimited physically. She's a very energetic and dogged woman. Her love for God and determination has strengthened her to become what she is. She has inspired many people through sharing her story. If you do not mind, please let us give a rousing welcome to Miss Toyi Adeshola. You can do better than that. Let's celebrate her.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you so much. It's an honor to be here today. I've been listening to all the speakers, and there's one recurring theme, and that is the positive and impactful care of people with sickle cell. Living with sickle cell has its challenges. But I always believe that it's not without the necessary care and impact that we give people with sickle cell. You know, there's this quote that I like, and it says that the strongest people are not those that survive battles. Are not those that survive battles unscathed, but those that bloom in the midst of adversity. Good morning, my medical professionals. it's good to be around my father's colleagues, especially Professor Akishete, Professor Akiyoju, and Dr. Kuku. And some of whom have been part of my life growing up as a child. And I honor you and honor your presence. Fellow warriors, we are warriors, we are one. Amen. and ladies and gentlemen, I'm pleased today. It's an honor to be invited to speak on surviving and thriving in the midst of sickle cell. I want to use this opportunity to thank Dr. Akichete and Sixel Foundation for inviting me to share my story and share the importance of how to manage our work and our journey in sickle cell. My name, as I said, is Tony Adeshola, otherwise known as the Resilience Boss. I don't need explanation on that. Like the man said, I stand before you as an author, as a wellness coach. I just recently launched my merchandise brand, and I'm an artist. I paint. I'm a six-year warrior, but most importantly, an advocate. An advocate with a voice. An advocate that wants to create change. So let me start by telling my personal story. I've been able to manage myself, but I must say that I've undergone very numerous blood transfusions. That is one thing that is very common with people with sickle cell. In 2 years, I'll be 60, for your information. So in my 50 years of living with sickle cell, I had no less than 2 blood transfusions a year. You can calculate that, how many blood transfusions. No less than 2. Some I had 3, some I had 4. And endured 5 surgical operations. I have both AVN on my hip and on my shoulder, and that's why I'm using a motorized wheelchair. I suffer from peripheral neuropathy, which is a nerve disorder, which affects you. You live in 24-hour pain. Then also, I have been diagnosed with doctors, the one where it's C4 and C5, a nation of, which is affecting my spine and other complications. But despite these complications that keep pounding me every year, it does not stop me. As you listen to my bio, I'm sure you were like, this woman, no, they stop. But that's me. I believe in achieving, in doing something to impact my environment. Now, what does it mean to survive? To survive, next slide. To survive means to endure, overcome, persevere through challenges, circumstances, and difficulties. In other words, it means to be resilient, pushing through whatever challenges that come your way. I see a lot of warriors let their challenges dictate how they become. And parents sometimes add to that. You're telling your child negative stuff, they will believe it. But the truth of the matter, no matter the circumstances, no matter the challenges that come your way, they can achieve what they want to be. We need to stop them from having the proverbial pity party. And that comes to thriving. To thrive means to flourish, to grow and prosper in all aspects of life, despite the challenges we face. So surviving is staying in one position. Oh, let me manage myself. At least I'm okay here. I'm not going beyond this. At least I'm eating my daily square bills. But you're not growing. You're not growing in education. You're not growing in knowledge. Knowledge of your environment. Knowledge of your sickle cell disease. Because I see people always going to hospitals and you ask them, what did the doctor say? I don't know. You are a patient. You have the right to know what they give you, what they are doing to you. Is it your right? And if you are not satisfied with the results or the treatment you are giving, you have the right to go see another doctor. It's not to say, they said, so I'm resigning my life to that. I'll give you a story. They were talking about care, and unfortunately, care is expensive in this country. Because to be a sickle cell warrior, You need different specialists around you. I can count how many. Neuropathy, neurology, cardiology. You have all of them. But it's important. I'm sorry to say it's very important. Because along the line, you will experience some of these challenges that you need to see some of these doctors. That's why it's good when you go and see your GP. Your GP, the hospital you go to, you must ensure that they have the necessary specialists that they can attend to you at any given time. Are you seeing a hematologist? We just manage with GP and that's it. But no, it's not every doctor that knows how to manage sickle cell. So it's very important. So I just want to talk to you about, next slide. First of all, the power of the mind. Our minds are incredibly powerful. If you don't believe it, just look at different people who have different disabilities, different problems, who have been able to persevere and become the best in who they are. There's a guy called Nick Vujicic, no hands, no legs. But today he's a well-known speaker around the world. And there are so many of these people, some with cerebral palsy, some with other forms of disorder or disease, but they choose to push through their minds and become the best they can. Together we can explore practical strategies to reframe our thoughts. Sometimes you need to see a behavioral change person to be able to reframe our thoughts, because there have been trauma influenced information that has made you accept certain things about yourself over time. And you need to see somebody who can break that system out of your mind to become your best. So we need to conquer the challenges we face and stop thinking negative because I'm living with sickle cell. To tell you the truth, you may not want to believe it, but there are worse health problems than what you're facing. Some people are going through a lot more. And it is only when we reframe our minds to believe that we can do what we need to do and what we want to be, that is the only way that we can push and thrive and flourish. Then finding purpose in our journey is essential. Why are you here? Why are you here? We should all ask that question, not just as sickle cell warriors. Why am I here? What am I doing? What is my impact in this world? Sickle cell may have chosen you, but we have the power to choose how we respond to it. Sharing stories about our purpose, leveraging on our experience, and making a meaningful impact is what we are here for. When God brought us into this world, He didn't bring us to this world for ourselves. He brought us to this world for others. And that is one important thing we should take away with us. But we shouldn't stop there in trying to survive and thrive. We should practice self-care and well-being. They are very crucial aspects to achieving, to thriving with sickle cell. We need to get to the point of managing pain. How do we manage our pain? Unfortunately, a lot of us think managing our pain is by stuffing ourselves with pentazocine. And that's why we have a lot of dependence and addiction. And it's because we don't want to go to hospital. Because the truth of the matter, you don't know how to manage that dosage. It's only the doctor can tell you that, okay, this is the amount. But you get so used to, I have a friend, my sister's friend, addicted to paint. And it's been a struggle for their family. You know, and I see it on a regular basis. People have their hand amputated because of the number of times they injected themselves and they get ulcers. So it's very important that we practice self-care. Boosting energy levels, prioritizing our physical, emotional, and spiritual well-being. What is our relationship with God? How do we impact that? Together we can explore the incredible power of self-care and how it can transform our lives. Take a break. take a holiday. I know Nigerians, we don't like to take holidays. If you do, even if you do holiday somewhere, we'll go and find how we can make money from there. But it's important to, and this is speaking to me as well, because I'm a workaholic. But it's important that we need to step back, reevaluate our lives, reevaluate what our goals and purpose in life is, and then move on from there. And then here's the exciting part I love. When I took to, or I got a call, I'll call it more of a call, to start the NGO in 2005, I was thinking, what's my own business with starting an NGO? What's my own problem with helping other people? Because at that time, I was going through a lot. But the truth of the matter is, as soon as I started the NGO, I tell you, if you think you have a problem, I tell you, you say another person's problem, you thank God for your own. That's the reality. And starting the NGO made me realize that we have a lot of impact to put in the world. We can create a community of strength and resilience by sharing our stories, educating others, and supporting fellow sickle cell warriors. You know, some of us have unique talents, and we tend to hide it because we are afraid of what people will say when they find out that we have sickle cell. But it's those talents that can change people's lives. It's those talents that can inform people to become the best they can be. Then you need to advocate for yourself. I've already talked a bit about that. Speak up, ask for help, communicate your needs, educate others about sickle cell disorder or disease, depending on where you're coming from. And advocate for better healthcare and support. Don't stop. I remember we had this, they talked about me being a host of a radio show. I remember we had it. It was very difficult to get people with sickle cell to come on the show because everybody wants to hide. No, I don't want them to know I have sickle cell. But the truth of the matter is, if we don't speak out, nothing will change. You cannot inform the next generation if you don't speak out. And that's why it's important to be able to do that. Connect with support groups and healthcare providers. Stay active and practice your self-care while doing so. But advocate for yourself. Advocate for others. It's very important. As I said before, it's your right to know what your doctor is doing. At the same time, it's your right to help somebody who may not have that opportunity that you have to become the best they can be. Last and the final step. Build a support community. It doesn't have to be a community of sickle cell. I remember I was telling somebody that growing up, I decided not to, I think it's in my latter years, that I started joining people who had sickle cell. Because I didn't want a situation is, I have sickle cell, you have sickle cell, the other person has sickle cell. And we all have an attitude of, woe is me. Ah, you see the other day, oh, I had crisis. By the time you listen to that repeatedly, you, exactly. So I never, ever, till I was in my late 20s, associated with communities of just, no, they understand my, yes, I understand, you understand. But nobody will bring you up better than people outside of that community. Because they have walked the walk, they have talked the talk, and they are educated in knowing what challenges that can face in social situations, societal changes, you know, your workplace, your career, everything, your business. Step out of that environment and build a community, stay in a community that can help you in these areas. Because you are born to thrive, you are born to grow, and nothing should and can stop you from doing that. I want to emphasize to all my fellow warriors that our condition does not define us. Our strength and resilience goes beyond the physical challenges we face. Together we can thrive by celebrating our achievements, embracing our passion, and unleashing those full potentials that are in us. Before I conclude, I want to express my gratitude to all the medical professionals and parent caregivers for your unflinching support, because without you guys, People like us will not be standing here today. And that's the truth of the matter. I use this opportunity to even celebrate my mom, who celebrated her 90th birthday recently, because she stayed on the course. Regardless, in fact, up to today, I'm still like a small child. What are you doing? Where are you going? But I thank God for that parental care over through the years. And that's why I celebrate our parents, our caregivers, because I know it's not easy. And you too need to take time to practice self-care. Don't continually focus on the challenges that you are doing, helping your child. Because if you are not well, the child is not well. Let us support one another, celebrate our resilience, and positively impact the world. Thank you for your attention. And as we continue this journey of surviving and thriving with sickle cell, may we all succeed in Jesus' name.
Let's celebrate Ms. Toyin Adeshola. I want to say thank you very much for that presentation. Very touching and very erudite in that communication. I want to say something to every one of us before we call on two testifiers who will be sharing with us briefly their testimony. Is the fact that the question Ms. Toyin Adeshola is asking us a question. If I can do this with my life, what are you doing? What is your excuse? Why can you not? And so persons like her judge many of us consistently when we come up with excuses. You can either make progress or make excuse. You can't do both. And that is very important for us. I'd like to invite to come and share triumphs and tribulation. A mother of a child with sickle cell disorder, our first testifier. We have two of them. We'll take the first person, Mrs. Vivian Kezi. Please come. Please appreciate her as she comes. She's going to share triumphs and tribulation, her testimony.
Thank you so much. Good day, all. I'm happy to be part of this great meeting of great minds. Like when I was called upon to testify, I was like, I don't really know how I got into it, but when it happened, I had my son, that is in 2009. I started noticing some kind of, he wasn't growing well. So I went to the hospital where I had him, and the doctor was like, "What's your genotype?" I was like, "AS." "What about your husband?" I was like, I asked him, but he didn't say anything. But I think he's A. Now said, "Okay, let's run the test," which we did. And it was discovered that my son is SS. So I was like, and I wasn't really staying with the dad. So I had to call him. I was like, "What's your genotype?" Said he didn't want to tell me, blah, blah, blah. I was like, he didn't want to tell me. Okay, I kept quiet. I started taking care of the boy. The doctor told me there's this place that you have to go to, and that's the Sickle Cell Foundation. He was the one that directed me here. So I came here, and after much, they now directed me to Bagada General Hospital. And ever since then, we've been going there. They've been giving us drugs. Anytime I have appointment, I always take him there. And I make sure I talk to the teachers. I tell them, "My son is SS. Please don't stress him." I always tell the teachers. Even when they have sports, he will want to do everything they are doing. But the teacher will be like, "No, I have to call your mommy," and you start crying. But they always stand by that. He likes to swim, but the teachers will say, "No, your mommy said you can't swim." So I had to start telling him about sickle cell, even if I don't even, but because I attend most of the lectures and everything, I was able to educate him more on what the disorder he's having. So ever since then, he has been doing well, and he takes his drugs, he takes water, he avoids cold things. There's this story I would always want to tell wherever I go to. I took him on a trip one time. We went to Oyo State. So while we were there, I noticed he was, if I didn't know about it, I wouldn't know he's about to have crisis. That was about 12 in the midnight. I just noticed he was about to have crisis. I was like, oh God, this is crisis, so I just have to do something. And I don't know anywhere around. I just carried my son and we went downstairs. I entered my car. I started driving to, I don't even know where I was driving to. It was so late in the night. You can't even ask anybody, please. Luckily, I saw somebody. I was like, please, is there any hospital around here that I can? So they directed me. I drove down to the hospital and I saw the doctor. So immediately I just, and it was like, everybody has been trained. I don't even, most of the doctors, they've been trained about sickle cell. So immediately I explained to the doctor that my son is sickle cell. He just did what he had to do. The next morning, we didn't even waste time. I started running down to Lagos because I know this where I can get help and where they know our situation. So to cut the long story short, I didn't marry him because he's AS and I'm AS. So I don't want to bring another child into this world again and start stressing. So let me just face this one. And I got married to someone else though. He's AA. And we have a daughter who is AS. So I don't see the need why parents or young ones, they just have to know. Many doctors have said it. Go and run a test. Run this test. So if you are AS and he's AS, please, let's not bring these children to this world to suffer. It's not like we like seeing them suffering. We don't like it. We too, as mothers, we have our pains. We feel pains. We spend money. Like now, maybe you have somewhere to go to, but because of your child, you can't do it. You have something to do, but because of your child, you can't leave your child for someone else to take care of. That person is your child. You are the one that knows him or her. So you are in the best position to take care of that child. As the last speaker said, please, parents, please, I beg of you, stop telling these children. Some people say you are my problem. You are the one that is making me not to move forward. You are this. Please, parents, let's stop it. Let's take care of these children. They are our treasure. They will always make us proud. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ms. Casey. Our second testifier, sickle cell champion 65 and living with sickle cell, Mrs. Modupe Popola. Please appreciate her as she comes.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, sirs. Professor Akinyoju, I call him my dad, because he did a lot of things in my life. So I give kudos to you, sir. Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon, everybody, the medical doctors, the warriors in here, and everybody working to make this day a success. Being a warrior for almost 65 years, it's not a joke. And going through the pains right from babyhood, you know what it entails. I was diagnosed at 5 months. Just like my Toyin said, if you don't have a caring mother, if you don't have a loving mother, if you don't have somebody that treasures you, I don't think you'll be able to survive it. So I give kudos to my mom. She's going to be 93 in September. And I'm actually the one taking good care of her. She never knew I would be the one to stay by her. So mothers here, I treasure you. I give kudos to you. And I pray that all your efforts over these children will not go in vain. As you suffer over them, they will take good and perfect care of you. I'm actually not here to talk about my experiences. I just said that to buttress and to use myself that sickle cell is not a death sentence. I see myself as a champion for living through it. In pains, when you talk about pains, excruciating pains, that is more than a labor pain. That is what we had gone through. So I think that is what I'm going to say in respect of that. I'm going to talk about Sickle Cell Foundation and the support that we get from Sickle Cell Foundation. I think I got to know Professor Akinyoju when I was 38 years after my marriage. I got married at the age of 38. And ever since I knew him, he brought me to the foundation. I didn't have any cause to regret joining the foundation. The support that the foundation that they give, number one, creating clubs. We have clubs, sickle cell clubs, all over Nigeria. And I think I am the coordinator for Ifako Ijayi Club. We have Ikorodu in Lagos. If I can mention the ones we have Ikorodu, Gbagada, Surulere, Badagry. We have all over Lagos. And what do? We come together, bringing our warriors together. We have meeting days where we meet. And at that meeting, what do? We have our doctors, the hematologist, that comes into our midst to brief us. And without the clubs, it is what the foundation, because they want to touch every one of the warrior that is a member. And so they give us all the necessary support we need, as in medications. They supply us with medications. And when you look at what the foundation does, without their support, I don't think we'll be able to achieve what we are achieving today. Is it in researches? When you look at it, all the researches, what they have gotten to do, the genetic counseling, the prenatal diagnosis that has been mentioned, most of these things have been mentioned. The leg ulcer treatment. Lately, I started having leg ulcer. It isn't funny at all to have leg ulcer. But if we have the foundation there, taking it upon itself to treat patients, I'm sure we have seen people with leg ulcer. I was taking pictures of my legs when the ulceration started, to see what it entails and how the improvement is coming. So for the foundation to take it upon itself, treating people with leg ulcer, I think we need to give kudos to them. About the genetic counseling, I think that is a big one, because most of the counselors, when they see people, there was a time, I think a parent, they were in front of one of the counselors and they were shedding tears. Fortunately for me, I walked in. And when I walked in, Mommy Otaigbe said, thank God, Mrs. Pokwola, I just spoke about you. And so I think that brings a lot of encouragement as I am standing here today, to encourage most of the parents that are here, that if you take proper care of your children, automatically they will live to a good old age as I am living. God bless you. Now, when you look at that's about the, and then the foundation to alleviate the burden of sickle cell disorder patients. Yes, when you look at it, how do they do it without support? We need a lot of support from them. And I think they are doing a lot to support us medically. And then the training. For me as a person, I train sickle cell disorder patients. I train them in a field that I am into. I am into catering, and I run a training institute. So any of the warriors that is interested, I train them. When you look about the TCD, it's about stroke. And then you find out that most of these are parents can really not afford this. We give the support. I give the support, and I think I started it before I got support from Healthy Life Foundation to support these parents in paying the fees for the TCD. So with all this, you find out that the foundation, they run a lot of programs, and they are actually doing well, helping us as warriors. Thank you so much, and I pray that all our parents that are here, you should key into all these programs. When you key into it, you'll be able to take care of your children, and then they will survive it. Thank you so much. God bless you.
I appreciate Mrs. Kokwola. Thank you very much, ma'am. We're going into a session for 20 minutes. We've been managing time phenomenally well. If you look at our program, it's 1:31, and the next agenda is for us to have questions, answers, and discussion. I'll be inviting to the elevated platform Professor Edamisa Temiye, Professor Titilokpe Adeyemo. I will be inviting Ms. Toyin Adeshola to join us. And this session will be moderated. It's a 20-minute session. You are empowered, authorized, encouraged, admonished, requested to ask questions. Ask questions. You will ask questions of them, and then they will also share and answer those questions. Dr. Annette Akinshete will be moderating this session for us. I will yield the microphone to her. Eshegoni, I have been reliably informed. If you will, tebafe bere, ibere ni edewa, ni yonu koko, kosiwa la ema bere. Oye won, wa shala efunwa, wa sojade, show Yoruba lemi no.
Thank you very much, Director of Programs of Ceremonies. Welcome to this session on questions and answers. But we're going to look at it as a discussion. So it's going to be two-way. You know, we have actually said it's a panel discussion, but we wanted our speakers to say something on their topics to lay the foundation. So I'm sure by now, in your minds, many things are going on. So take a few notes and ask your questions when they come. To kick off, I'll just call on our chairman, Olorogun, Dr. Sonny Kuku, to just set the stage for us and ask any questions on your mind of these panelists. Any question. If you don't, we can start with the audience.
Clearly, management of sickle cell disease has progressed tremendously in the last few decades. Can we know what you think is the most significant advancement that has brought up to where we are today? It could be two, it could be three. And please put them in order. Thank you.
Okay, Chairman has asked, which is the most significant advancement in this sickle cell space over the years? I think, Professor Temiye, I think this falls right up your alley. So after your presentation, please help us answer that question.
Thank you very much, sir.
One or two or three.
Okay. I think the most significant progress we've made is that science and the society understand what sickle cell disorder is now. We know exactly what we are dealing with. We know how we can prevent a lot of the effect of the disorder. And we have effective treatment for the crisis that sickle cell disorder patients go through. We can also prevent someone, or we can help a family prevent having children with sickle cell disorder, one way or the other. We can. Either premarital or after marriage, of course, if we know, we can now make a prenatal diagnosis and we can take steps. Information are available, and when you are educated, it can help you to take informed decision on how to move forward.
Thank you very much, Professor Temiye. Indeed, knowledge is power. I think you've answered Olorongu's question by saying that we now know. So research over the years has brought us to a place where we have a better understanding of what sickle cell is all about. The pathophysiology, as you showed us in a couple of your slides. Because when you understand, you know what to do. When you know better, you do better. I think that is something we should take away from. But before you leave the microphone, even if you have it, talk to us about herbal remedies. I'm saying this because during this period of World Sickle Cell Day, the entire month, questions have been coming to us on our social media space, on telephone, on email, asking that, oh, we have these herbal cures. We have herbal treatments. Okay, your presentation did not address that. Can you just talk to us about that in a few sentences, quickly? Herbal treatments, herbal cures. And then they keep one of the things one doctor said to me is, we tend to push down our own things that pertain, that our own Nigerians, our own traditional communities come up with and promote what the Western world gives to us. What do you say to that, Dr. Professor Temiye?
Well, it's two-edged sword. A lot, from what I've shown, you could see that a lot of molecules have been identified and have anti-sickling property when you test them in the laboratory. When you use them and you subject them to what we call clinical trials, they fail. About 80 to 90% of them fail to produce any result. That is the danger. The claim, everybody rises and says, this my herbal product is working. It will cure somebody. I will ask you, have you tested this in a scientific manner, what we call clinical trial? If there is no clinical trial, I will not recommend. If I've shown you about about 30 drugs here today. And I'm telling you that only three of them have been found to work when they are subjected to trials. And these are trials that are funded, NIH-funded trials. The issue we have in Nigeria is that we have not gotten to that stage in which we subject every of those products to trials. And if you don't do it, you cannot say this is working. Okay, I've been involved in Solamine. I've tested Solamine, yes. I've got involved with Ciclavit. Indeed, when we were first testing Ciclavit, we doubted it was going to work. And then we tested and we saw something. Hesitantly, we decided to publish. We published it. Other people have done study. I think we have about four or five publications now on Ciclavit that have shown that, yes, this thing should be working. But we need, the company has sponsored a phase two trial, which has some effect, but we need to sit down and do a phase three trial.
So I hear you, Professor.
If you don't do a study, I will not recommend you, because some of them can actually cause some problem. One of them, I think, it has a, what does it have? When patients use it for a long time, it causes some paralysis. In fact, I have to seize one of them from one of my patients when it came, and the child was already dragging the feet, and it was not stroke. And I have to seize it and say, no, you cannot use this anymore. So some of them can be dangerous when they use it.
Let me come to Professor Adeyemo. What are your thoughts on this? Very quickly, because I'm harping on this, because we're getting this kind of pushback from the sickle cell community and from families that we're not promoting what is ours. Have we done enough in our country as Nigerians, as the, in the healthcare space, in the medical space, in the field? Have we done enough to promote local remedies, these herbs that we're talking about? Professor Adeyemo.
Thank you for that question. I would say that we haven't. For us to be able to say a drug works, it has to go through efficacy and safety trials. Okay, we have to have tested it to say it works, and then also test it to say it is safe. But most of the drugs that we see being pushed to us to start to use have not gone through these stages. Okay? When we say efficacy trials, it is rigorous. Okay? When you're using it, you have to also consider every other thing around that time to say this is why it is working or this is why it is not working. And it is usually very costly to do real-time efficacy trials. It's capital intensive. And then most of the molecules we have locally, they do not have that fund, okay, to fund such trials. So, but they are just pushing it into the market. Another thing is the safety trial, okay? I mean, the safety of those medications, the safety aspect. It has to have undergone rigorous safety tests to say it is safe and it is effective. As I said, it takes a lot of funds to do that, and most of our locally available molecules do not have that fund. It's just pushed to the market, and then we don't have the evidence to say it works or it does not work.
Okay, I hear you too, Professor Adeyemo. But what I hear there loud and clear is funding or lack thereof. So that funding, where can we get it? Even if locally, where can we get such funding? Because it is necessary. And we are our sickle cell families, friends, community, they're getting more and more aware, and they're asking questions, and we need to provide answers. Okay, if we say that we have the capacity to do the research, to do the clinical trials, well, our problem is funding. Where can we get this funding? Are we encouraged? Is it the private sector? Should we encourage and push and, you know, reach out to the private sector for funding, so we can have these clinical trials?
Okay, it's both the private and the government, okay, that have to fund this trial. The private sectors have to put some money for research and development, okay, to research these molecules and these products. The government too have to support. This is how it's done all over the world. Government supports, the private sector supports. Yes, eventually it may add to the cost of the products, because usually the private sector will push the cost of that research. Okay, so those expensive drugs for sickle cell that we see in the market now, the crizanlizumab, the velvozetol, they are so expensive, because of the amount of money that has been sent, that have been funded and been put into researching them. So if we are going to do the same, okay, the private sector have to come into fund. They will of course want to recover their money, okay, by adding the money to the cost of it. Then government can come in to bring down those costs, okay, by also adding to the cost of funding for these molecules. But yes, we do need to research our locally available products.
Remedies, because
as we have had all over this morning, we are the epicenter for sickle cell disease. We have to fund the research.
Okay, so I hear there that we must push public-private partnership in this area of research. Mm-hmm. So let me come over to the audience. Questions. Taloni Berry. Emi na ngbo Yoruba. Okay, there are many hands up. Please help us with a microphone. Hands up for questions for the panelists. Please ask anyone. And please let us know who should answer your question of the panelists.
Okay. Introduce yourself, please.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, the chairman, the panelists, all other protocols observed. Thank you for this amazing workshop today. My name is Ofotalo Paulinus. I'm representing the Registrar CEO of Medical Lab Science Council of Nigeria. I'm the zonal coordinator for our council in the Southwest. First, I want to thank the organizers for extending the invitation to our organization. And we are glad to be here and will always want to support quality infrastructure developed towards any of the health indices in Nigeria. And we want to identify in a very special way the entire topics that have been presented here today. And most importantly to me is that they've all mentioned testing, diagnosis, and some of the speakers have talked about the gaps that we have in diagnosing sickle cell disorders. And that informs the need for us to network, to partner, to empower our regulatory agencies to be able to deliver the quality infrastructure that are needed to be able to police our diagnostic sector, without which we may continue to sing the same song year over and over. So I want to advocate that there is need for us to partner with different professional bodies to enable the Medical Laboratory Science Council, which I represent here in particular, to be able to deliver on their mandate. Because severally we've seen them go for national regulations and they are stopped by political forces and professional inter-rivalry. You understand better what I'm talking about. So I want to use this forum to actually appeal to all Nigerians to see the need for all of us to synergize to better police our health system. The second thing I want to talk about is...
Okay, that's not a question. You're just advocating.
It's just an advocacy.
Okay, the
question,
please.
Second one now is the question proper. I'm glad that you talked about the issue of natural remedy or local herbal remedy. I was particularly touched by the guest speaker when he talked about the discovery of the cyclovit from a natural source, from our own local herb, which takes all of us back to the origin that God having endowed Nigeria with this sickle cell solution. That's what I understand from that presentation. But I was touched when Prof was saying something. He said he was a bit hesitant when they researched and they did clinical trials in publishing the outcome, that he was hesitant. That speaks to something to me. It means even though we have even discovered some of the solution, we are not still comfortable with our solutions within our own locality. And that's a problem.
What was the reason he advanced?
He advanced that he doesn't trust the level
for
of
what
clinical
reason?
Trials.
For what reason? No. There was a particular thing he mentioned. Yes.
He said he was not Okay. Maybe you can recall so that. Pardon?
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much for.
Sorry, let me just conclude so that you can take. I thought you wanted to give me. So the point I'm making is that we should look at our local content and give opportunities from our professionals to pursue clinical trials, the proper safety and clinical trials that should be given to natural remedies from our locality. Because if we don't do that,
thank you very much.
Integrative medicine will not be promoted, and our people will continue to use the remedy.
Let Professor respond to that.
Thank you very
quickly.
Thank you very much. You see, that hesitancy you are talking about happens with every product. The very first study we did was open label. What we call open label study, and it's the very first step in doing a clinical trial. But no, okay, it's not the first step. The first step has been done. We have tried it on animals, and we found out that this product was safe. It was not going to kill the animals. It was not going to damage their liver. It didn't damage their kidney. It didn't affect their brain. We've done that, and that has been published. So the second step is, we lead damage a human being. So while we are doing that, we lead damage a human being, and then we found out that this thing does more than it's not going to damage. Okay? And when you are doing something that is new, it is not, it happened to every scientific discovery. When you are finding something that is new, there's hesitation that, is it here for a while? So, and it is when you hesitate and you said this thing may, if you look at the first publication, you will see this thing might be working. We saw so it might be. You want somebody else to confirm. I'm telling you today now that I've seen four, five, six, in fact, I've seen some papers, now they've reviewed them on systematic reviews about that, yes, it seems as if this thing is working. It is then you start having confidence. It takes years for a molecule to be discovered, apart from drugs against COVID-19 that was given accelerated, and you see what happened to some of them. Eventually it was found out that they were actually not working as they are supposed to work, because you have not gotten enough time to observe over time across populations. And that is why it takes 10 years, 15 years, some time for a molecule to be registered as medication. And that's the process we are going through.
Thank you very much, Professor. I think we have to manage our time. Thank you very much for responding to that. And please, before I go back to the audience, let me engage our one and only T for Toyin, as I call her. Toyin, you are a huge inspiration. I think it's evident for all to see. I want to thank you for the very erudite presentation you made, sharing your story. And really, I know if you had time, you'd speak for 10 hours. Because you really have a lot to learn from you. But having said that, I want to touch on two points with you. One is something that you didn't mention in your presentation today, and that has to do in a little way with treatment and part of what we're talking about, research. You may not have had formal research, but in terms of food and diet for persons with sickle cell, how has that helped you, and how have you seen that help persons with sickle cell? What should they eat? How does it help them? That's one. I want to hold on to that. Hold on. Put that in your left hand and hold it. The second one that I want to talk about here is, you spoke about the need to use hospitals that have various specialists. What about the cost? We are talking to patients and some of them are here. What about the cost? If you go to a hospital where they have various specialists, I assure you that hospital is going to be expensive. You know, the specialists that take $20,000 for seeing your face. Okay, so first of all, talk to us about the food, simple things.
Okay, for the food, one of the things I know is very common, everybody talks about hydration, drinking a lot of water. And when I say water, I mean water, not Ribena, not Fanta, not Coca-Cola, or what's that thing, Capisoni. You pack Capisoni into the person's child school bag. And forget that the person needs water. Water is very integral for us as warriors. In fact, I don't like it. I only take take the sugary stuff because of my medicines. I take about 13 drugs, so I need to push it down. But when we need to take water, and we need to try and avoid too much sugary things. I know we as kids, we have been taught to take these biscuits. It's easy for parents to look for those things, but look for more healthy, cheaper options. I remember growing up, I had this, which is why I talked about specialist. I had gallstones, and I couldn't take anything with fats. I didn't take anything fried, no stew, no biscuit. All I ate with my food was ewedu or okra.
Without oil.
Without any stew of any kind. Just so, rice, ewedu, okra. Eba, ewedu, okra. And whatever, ewedu, okra. Yam, ewedu, okra. That was my life. But, you know, I realized one thing. Because they are vegetables, they had a lot of impact in one's metabolism, immunity, and all that. You may think, okra, we do all the time. But growing up, those things are very important for a child. Vegetable. I was remembering, I was talking to my hematologist and I complained about folic acid. Why do I have to take 5 milligrams compared to the one that they do abroad, which is in micrograms and all that? And he told me, like, the truth of the matter is, Oyibo people, they chop vegetable plenty. But in Nigeria, we hardly take vegetables. So that's why we have to subsidize with the folic acid.
The vegetable we eat, we cook it a lot.
We cook it, yes. We cook it a lot. Okay. Yes. So that's it. Take a lot of vegetables, drink plenty of water, avoid all these sugar things. And you saw that. Then to your second question.
So before you leave that, let me just point out that one of our speakers in a virtual meeting said, to persons with sickle cell and their parents and their caregivers, their mothers, whenever you go out to the market to buy, they just buy fruit in season.
Yes.
Fruit in season. If it's mangoes, buy. If it's oranges, buy. Whatever you find, as long as fresh fruits and vegetables.
But
for
take
our children.
But mind you, they need to take the yes
because watermelon.
You have to choose like watermelon. Pineapple has a lot of sugar, so you have to reduce the number of things that have those fruits that have those sugar.
In moderation. So yeah. Quickly to the next, that's the second question.
Yeah. So the second question on the specialist, Ambo, welcome in. Question on the specialist. That's why I was trying to beat the time. So I didn't talk so much about those areas. One thing I found out is that we need health insurance. In this country, it's a pain to get healthcare financing for sickle cell warriors, especially. They say they don't deal with BS, this condition. They don't deal with chronic disorder or whatever. So you are battling with them to give you health financing. So I would suggest that government should try and find a way to help in this area because it's very. I did health financing. It's helped me quite a bit, but the hospital I use is pretty expensive. And my plan, I finished it in 3 months.
You know, for 1 year.
Yes, and they do this thing called calibration, where they will analyze how much you have used for the year. Then the next year, they now increase it by 2 times. So the truth of the matter, government, private sector, we need to push for health insurance, not just for people with sickle cell, but non-communicable disease in general. It's very important because without this, we can't survive. And we have the best brains in this sector of people with chronic illness. So don't push them aside as because they have chronic illness, they are not people to.
I'm happy to say that I'm not sure if Dr. Debbie Odo is still there from Federal Ministry of Health. The Ministry of Health is already putting that together. A package for healthcare financing for non-communicable diseases. But they need to carry everyone along. All the actors and all stakeholders there should be carried along in health for healthcare financing. So back to the audience. A question from the audience very quickly. Microphone, where are you? Okay, there's a lady that... what's her name? A man or a lady? Okay, the lady with hijab. Okay.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Say your name, please.
And my name is asking. Mrs. Abdul Ghanim. My question is that I have four sickle cell, but two have left. But the two that remain, anytime one has a crisis, the second one will say, ah, my mommy, my leg too is paining me. Hey, Joba, I'll actually move by your own do loto.
Attention.
Maybe it will need attention. But mama, she, kine, but mama, be but I'll pay on renew, repay, but in pampa, a layer, the hen. And also, you are an engineer. You are a lawyer, lo ma she. Matwa po mani engineer. Oh, lawyer. But come at the oro school ngba mi ah mo mi sha tun ma law school le ni oh. Mo ni engineer ma nka we ni. But oh, like anything. Omo ma na, omo ma sha ma she bi pe ara nro won bi.
Okay, let me keep professor down. Professor Temiye, please.
Emma, ọgbọ́n le ma lo fun won. Ekin ni pe mo ma so fun awon obi pe ti en to ni sickle cell ba ni ibi kan dun ohun. The first thing pe ma n gba pe o n dun looto. Pe mo boya looto lo n dun ba kin so to ni. To ba de n dun egun to n ro won yen kin se kekere.
So let's be quiet, please, so that we can hear Professor. Quiet, please. Thank you.
Ikeji ni pe oro te so fun won o se pataki. Ke ki won laya pe bi eyan bi awon omo ti o ni nkan kan se ri be na lawon ri. Eh se lokurun. E ma farawa awon omo to lokurun. E fun what we call positive
affirmations.
Acclamation. Ba se pon lawyer engineer yen te to pon won kawe yen eh eh se ri te meji ba lo igba mi ko ba so pe around won pe ti wo ba so pe ese ndu e ti wo ba so pe pa ndu e ta lo fe ran ni keji lowo tin ba sin le nko so e be sin ko won bo se ma toju ara won nikan bo se le je eyan ton le gba pe okay o ko si nkan to se mi emi na je nikan ti ma di lapa je ti ma di temedo e opo yen e ma ko won sugbon ba ndu won looto o ye ke ina ke ti ma mo gba mi awon mo fe ma lo sile iwe to ba si kere e de gboro fun ni aye yen pe ko ma lo sile iwe te ba lo se
quiet please so we can hear prof. There's a lot of noise from this side of the hall.
Ati wahala si lorun ojo iwaju so e wo won dada e ko iya won le je na o to ba ni pain looto e ke le mo pe looto lele tin ko ndun to ba ni pain asopo ke je kin ba ko pa be yen ase pe yen ti lo. Okay, mura ya lo lewe. I could speak back. Oh, ni penjo ko bere si lo agbara pelu won. So you be wise, very wise dealing with them and pushing them to live as an individual without a that I have any disease, without
disorder.
A problem. Pe bi lapeja se wa to ni gankan be no ni wo wa. Occasionally le ni pain o awon ma ni pain gba mi. Ono le so you put positive thoughts to them and encourage them to do what you want them to do.
Thank you very much. Thank.
Program for children. Are you not coming for
clubs? Sickle cell clubs. Just register here if you're not a member.
Register in the sickle cell club and take them there. Follow the sickle cell club.
Thank you, Prof. Thank you, Professor. Because of timing, I want to call on our special guest, guest of honor, Professor Ebironke Akinshete, in case she has a question or a comment to share with the audience or question for the panelists, please. Professor Akinshete, please.
Thank you. The one I want to address is the one about herbal drugs. I know if you look at the population of people who have sickle cell disorders, majority, from what I learned from my clinical practice, go to native doctors. Majority go to native doctors. It is when they cannot deal with what is happening that they now refer to the hospital. And I think there is need for us to educate the native doctors. Because no matter what you do, they will go there first before they come to you. And therefore we as a foundation maybe need to work with the native doctors to tell them how to manage symptoms and tell them what is available, what is good and what is not good, what are the side effects. In this way, you will get their confidence. You'll be able to teach them what to do and when it's necessary to go to hospital. And I think the children, for instance, I think the children need to be taught to identify what triggers
the crisis.
They need to know what triggers crisis. Is it cold? Is it when you this or that? So that they know that this is going to be a crisis, I have to do something about it or how to manage it. It is very important. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ma. Thank you very much, Professor. So I think our time is really almost spent. Well, I'll take two questions from the audience now. Okay. Two. There's somebody that Auntie Toyin has been pointing at since. Please, if you know yourself, stand up.
All right.
Is she the one with the microphone? Okay, please go ahead. Somebody has a microphone.
My name is Obiageri Iheme, and I'm representing the Association of Medical Laboratory Scientists of Nigeria.
We already had somebody from
Lagos
you.
State. No, you have somebody from the council.
Okay.
Yeah. So my question now is, I've listened to all the lectures. It's really touching. Is there any first aid treatment that we can give to any sickle cell patient in crisis? Should it just arise? Those of us are not probably doctors. It's important for even the non-medical people in our midst to know the first aid treatment that can be given to these patients. Crisis arises at any time at all, not in the hospital or in the home. Thank you.
Maybe in school, at play, anywhere.
Anywhere.
So you have
first aid treatments.
What are you proposing? You could have an idea, a suggestion. Are you proposing something?
I want
to
hear from the professionals, from the doctors. Okay. We are responsible for running your test.
Professor Titi.
Thank you.
Would you want to take a dig at that?
Well, as part of comprehensive care for sickle cell, is that we teach patients and caregivers how to manage the sickle cell at home, how to manage the crisis at home. So management of crisis always starts in the house or in the school. And as part of the care we give them is to tell them what to do, how to identify the crisis, what brings it on, what relieves it, how to identify it, and what to do at home. And then we also teach them at what point must you get to the hospital, that there's a limit to what you can do at home. Okay, so for example, we tell mothers, you must have a thermometer at home. You must be able to measure temperature. If temperature is above 38, you must get to the hospital. Okay, or 38.5, you must get to the hospital. Maybe less than that, you can use paracetamol, start with that. Okay, you can have ibuprofen. So we tell them the different levels of care they can have at home. And at a point, and we also let them know what are the triggers to get to the hospital. Okay, if you see this, you can't manage this at home, you must come here. Okay, so for most mothers, they already have an idea. If they've been assessing care, they already have an idea about what to do when they have a crisis. And we also tell them, also let them know that they have crisis, they have a sickle cell disorder in the school and what the school should do, and they should get in touch with you as soon as they see that something is going wrong. So they already proceed.
Thank you very much, Professor Titi. And as a matter of fact, we are already having discussions about borrowing a leaf from the HIV and AIDS program, where there's multi-sectoral collaboration. So it's not going to be a health sector thing only. There's be the educational sector as well. And that will mean bringing teachers on board. So not only will there be something in sickle cell in the curriculum, but also that teachers know how to recognize the symptoms and signs of sickle cell, signs of crisis, what to do when they have the children are in crisis, and so on. And there are school healthcare programs and there are clinics in schools. So that is one way to go. One way forward is ensuring that we also have multi-sectoral collaboration for sickle cell. So I want a question to come from this side. Then there are questions on from persons online. The audience online, they also have questions. So very quickly from the left side of the hall.
Good afternoon.
Introduce yourself, please.
My name is Ms. Akinsusi. I want to talk about this ulcer.
Leg ulcer.
Actually, it happened to one of my daughter. I have four children and it's only one that has this. I never expect myself to be in this condition because I've experienced it. But when I want to go to the union, I'm AS. And I asked my husband, because they asked for it in our ministry, that we should go and do the test if you are compatible or not. But he came back and told me that it's AA. I said, no problem. I said, are you sure? He said, yes. But I've known my own. I've known my own status before. So he said, we go in. Not knowing that it's AS. So along the line, I have four boys. They are all AS. Then the fourth one is SS, which is a girl. So I now found that before I knew, it was late. I never knew. Then later, when this ulcer of leg came, we went to hospital. Me and the daughter, we went together. So when we got there, they said, "Yeah, we should be coming.
For dressing. Okay.
Then later on, they said they are going to operate. They are going to scrape it. When the girl heard about it, she ran away. She said she's no more going because she's old enough to go to the hospital for Ilepo. She said she's no more going. And I said, what am I going to do?
Okay,
and
what's your question? Let's address
my question now is that when we went to the harbor whatsoever, they treated her, it healed. Then later on, it came back. After we went back again, the man said, we do it. He did it again. We came back. Later, it developed again. So since then, I've been doing it by myself. We went to private hospital. That one, try that. He said, we are going to do something to, I don't know,
grafting.
Skin, something like that. And I said, so one of my friends, I said, go to a club. This is my fault. I said, I should come to a club that they are doing it. They will advise me. They will teach me how to manage her, how to do this. I've spent a lot of money concerning this leg ulcer. She don't used to have crisis, but this ulcer.
How is she today?
She's still having the.
Have you brought her to the center?
I brought her.
Okay.
They came to say, I'm going to do some series of tests,
yes,
which I don't have much of money to.
Uh-huh.
What they brought now is about 100 and something thousand.
Okay,
naira.
You know what? It's beyond the scope of this meeting. We'll see you after this meeting, okay? Outside the door.
All right.
So I want to take questions from the audience online, please. The Zoom questions, please. Kogito, please field two questions from our online guests. Please go ahead. Please introduce yourself and ask your question. Unmute yourself, ma. Kogito, please unmute her.
Yes, I think I've been unmuted. Thank you very much. Oh, it's been interesting. I would have been in Lagos personally. Without wasting time, I'm listening from Bayelsa State. I'm Mrs. Aladdin. If you are listening to me, I want to greet Professor Akinyoju and Mrs. Otaigbe. I've been there several times for meetings. My first question quickly is about Palodrine and the anti-malarials. I'm a caregiver the person is now over 40 years. I discovered that when we give Palodrine and stop, the malaria, it triggers the crisis to a level of almost, a terrible level. And also, anytime anti-malarials are taken or given, this person goes through crisis for 3 days. But as I was reading, I now discovered that when you add massive doses of vitamin C to the anti-malaria, the crisis is reduced or there may be no crisis. And we just tried it some months, about a month ago, and there was no crisis. I just want to bring it up. I also want to ask about Celloid S. One of the erudite professors, I think Olusotemiye, mentioned about cyclovite. I want to ask about steroid S. Steroid S, I don't know whether anything is being done about steroid S. And he mentioned something about hydroxyurea and L-arginine. I don't know what I can expatiate on that. And lastly, I don't know what nurses are doing. Are we just part of a group? Because we are the main caregivers. I think next time, nurses should be motivated to come and give a talk. And now they can assist all of us in the health sector to give proper care to our patients. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity, and God bless you all. Safe arrival for all of you. Thank you.
Our microphones. Okay. Thank you very much for the questions. Professor Temiye, please.
Yeah. Hello. Thank you very much for your question. Well, if you are taking paludrine or anti-malaria for a very long time, and you go off, if you have malaria, you are going to have severe malaria. The reason is that usually those who don't take drug, they have a low malaria infection, which keep their immunity going. When you have not have immunity to malaria for a long time, 3 years more, and you have malaria, that person who has severe malaria may die from it, whether he has a sickle cell disorder or not. So you should not stop your anti-malaria prophylaxis just like that. It can cause problems for you. Now, if you are taking anti-malaria and it is this, combination, don't take vitamin C with it. Yeah. It will knock out that anti-malaria. It will knock it out. Except if it's not malaria, you know vitamin C is an antioxidant. And sometimes when you take antioxidant, it may help modulate your crisis. That may be what is happening. But don't take vitamin C and the recombination anti-malaria therapy. Steroid S is one of the things I've worked on. And truly, it has anti-cycline property in the lab. It has anti-cycline property in the lab.
Hello, there's a lot of talking going on this side of the hall.
We have not conducted clinical trials on it. We've done laboratory, me and Professor Coker. We work on steroid S in the lab. It's okay. But like we said, we must subject, there are some of those things that I presented that have very beautiful anti-cycline effect in the laboratory. And when they now subject them to phase 3 clinical trial, where you now do a double blind trial in which you have these drugs, one of them is what I call empty. I won't call it fake. We call it placebo. And then we have the thing you are testing. You now divide your patient into two. And you give them, you that is giving it does not know the one that is active and the one that is not active. The patient does not know the one that is active and is not active. You don't treat them and see which one of them is working. It is the top of our clinical trial. It is when you come out with that study that I can say, yes, this medication is working. And many of these medications, when they go to that level, they fail. That's what I've shown you on those tables of long list of drugs. Many of them failed when they got to that level. Hydroxyurea, the baby hog study in UK, when they finished, the question they are asking is that, why are we not starting all sickle cell disorder patients on hydroxyurea from birth? Because it works so well, even for babies. So if you have a sickle cell disorder person, if the blood level is low, you should go on hydroxyurea. If he's having more than 3 pains a year, more than 3 painful crises a year, he should go on hydroxyurea. If I see a patient that have acute chest syndrome once, that patient goes on hydroxyurea. So hydroxyurea is very good for sickle cell disorder person, and we should use it as much as it is possible. But the person must be monitored, because if you give the hydroxyurea and you don't know how to give it, you can knock out the bone marrow. The person may suffer from severe anemia. It may affect the liver in some people. So they need to be monitored when they are taking hydroxyurea. L-arginine is an amino acid which is in our food, some of our food. Like I said, the beans, that is Cajanus cajan, has a lot of L-arginine.
Please describe that bean so that... Is it white
it's
beans?
It's white. It's a pigeon pea.
It takes long to cook.
Yeah, it takes longer to cook.
It's hard white beans.
Yes. Okay. It has a lot of
glutamine, there's a lot of phenylalanine, all the three, L-arginine, glutamine, and phenylalanine has been shown to have anti-sickling property and to have antioxidant property. So it has been shown that if you combine them, you are probably going to get a good... In fact, L-glutamine has been registered now by FDA for sickle cell disorder.
What about in Nigeria by NAFDAC?
Well, if the FDA register, NAFDAC will register if you come to, okay. If you come to Nigeria. Because a double-blind study has been conducted on it.
Okay, Professor, I think we should round up because of time. I am Director of Programs. Have we used up our time? We have used up our time. So I think, no, from the audience, from the online, or from... Okay, please go ahead. That's the last
good
question.
Good morning. My name is Alaka, Mrs. Alaka Sumbo. My daughter has been suffering from stroke since over 8 years now. And it took NSS treating. We took the drugs. Idozoria, she did DBT. She did everything. I took her to Lutz. She did EBT. Dr. Kishete recommended diagnosed that she did the EBT for eight times. After the EBT, yes, look at her. After the EBT, it was 3 months. Dr. Kishete said she should go and take TCD. She did it. After that, they said she doesn't need again to continue the EBT, that everything is fine. It's not after 3 months, she took another stroke. This is fifth time now. She has been suffering from the stroke for the past 8 years now.
I think we should see her after this meeting.
Look at her here. This is the fourth stroke.
Okay, madam. Sorry, we are very sorry. Please calm down. Calm down. Can I say something to you, madam?
Okay, let's have some quiet.
Please listen.
Professor will address this quickly.
I want you to listen to me carefully. You are not listening. You are still talking.
Hello. Too much talking. Can we be quiet?
Let me tell you this. In sickle cell disorder, some people present with something that doesn't fit very well into what we understand. There are some people who are prone to have stroke. When I was giving my lecture, I told you that one child had 4 strokes within 72 hours. Now, if a child has had stroke once, the recommendation for those who did 4 stroke study by blood transfusion is that you transfuse that child every month for 5 years. Did we transfuse your child every month for 5 years? No. So 8 times is very far from 5 years transfusion. That's number one. Number two, we are trying to do something now. You transfuse, then you start adoxuria with it. We are doing a collection and see whether that will shorten the period of transfusion because we don't have enough blood to transfuse in Nigeria. Number three, there are some children that after 5 years, so even in US, where they did the study every month, 5 years, a month after they stop the transfusion, they have stroke. We know it happens in some of them. The only treatment that can prevent that stroke is to do a bone marrow transplant. In those who are prone to stroke, if they have this repeated stroke, the only way you can stop it is to do a bone marrow transplant. It's not the fault of... In fact, eight transfusion is not enough. The minimum I will do with hydroxyurea is 7. Do the one when they have stroke, and then do it monthly for 6 months. Despite that, we found out that 2% of those we did it for still have stroke after we finish. So that we do that we have done it doesn't mean
thank you, Prof. Thank you, Professor. I think we should still see Madam after this meeting. So we'll take it away from this meeting and talk to you later. Yes. Mrs. Otaigbe, are you there? Please, you need to speak with her. I think we will round up now. Director of Programs, thank you for giving us of ceremonies the extra time. And I believe that at the end of the day, can we have some quiet, madam, please? Thank you. So let's just round up by just picking out one single thread that ran through our discussions today. one that jumps out of the top of my head is comprehensive care. Comprehensive care for persons with sickle. We are still talking. You have one house. Mrs. Please. You want to come and talk here? No, we can't take more questions. We can ask questions outside the meeting. Okay? So this question of comprehensive care, we need to take it away from this hall, from the four corners, four walls of this room, and engage with the government, engage with other partners, other actors and stakeholders, and be sure that we come up with a multi-sectoral plan for sickle cell management, care, and control. That's taking things forward. There's so much that needs to be discussed around sickle cell. We cannot exhaust it in one meeting. But I want to hand over now to the Director of Ceremonies, and I thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Akinshete. Thank you very much to our panelists. Thank you very much. I will be inviting Dr. Akinshete. She'll be coming. Please, can I have your attention, Ejo? I know that many of us, pupo nwa ibere yi wa lokan wa ejo nko de ma se ni wi pe te ba ti ta ba pari e ma lo ba wa ri won office wa ni side by gbogbo nkan to ba wa lokan yin lati bi won e ba wa bi won awon mummy to soro npa omo won won ti so pe Dr. Otaigbe won wa bi bai won ma fe re yin after now. Our warriors that have questions, we apologize that we're not able to take it, but the national director and the CEO has said that after this time, if we do not manage time effectively, when we invite people for next year, they will not come. And we don't want that to happen. We want you to also be able to come. So whatever question you have, we started on time, and we want to maximize time. Ejo, thank you very much for your patience. And we appreciate you. We're going into another session right now. No, don't worry. We're rounding off now. We have a few minutes. Dr. Akinshete, we have an award presentation to certain persons who have made significant contributions to the sickle cell disorder. Please appreciate them. Dr. Akinshete will be directing the affairs here. After that, Mrs. Abiola Ogunbi, a director within the Sickle Cell Foundation Nigeria, will be giving the communique and vote of thanks, and then we will take the national anthem. We are doing very well. Nipe Chetonsi, ko nipe warara. And then our chairman, okay, chairman Masoro, Rankpe, Ejo, ko nipe. Dr. Akinshete, over to you, man. Orchestra, thank you so much.
Okay, thank you very much, Pastor, and our Director of Ceremonies. And indeed, as he said, we just want to recognize a few persons. So many people have been involved in this fight, this for sickle cell control in Nigeria. And I keep saying, because Nigeria has the highest burden of sickle cell in the world, we should be in the forefront of this fight for sickle cell control. But this is just to appreciate those who have turned up and turned out for us in many ways. And to present this, the first award, I'll be calling on, can I have the first one? I'll be calling on Mrs. Ayo Otaigbe to kindly come forward, a director of the Sickle Cell Foundation Nigeria, to please help us present this award of recognition and for support in appreciation of your extraordinary contributions to medical practice in Nigeria. This goes to Olorogun Dr. Sunny Kuku, OFR.
On behalf of the Sickle Cell Foundation Nigeria, I present to you this plaque for all the contributions you have made in the health sector, for all the help you are giving to people, the needy in the society. We say thank you so much.
Thank you, Sickle Cell Foundation, for this great honor. I more than appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We really appreciate our chairman. I've hounded him for so long to please be here and, you know, chair the occasion. Just by his very presence, the gravitas, we are grateful to you, chairman. Okay, my next award here goes to none other than my yale, my auntie, Professor Ibirunke Akinshete, in appreciation of your extraordinary contributions to hematology and to the sickle cell cause. We want to appreciate you particularly for granting us this audience, allowing us invite you, pull you out of retirement to come here and spend time with us and be our special guest of honor. To present this, please, Mr. Taiwe, don't go away. I'm calling again on Mr. Taiwe to kindly present this award to Professor Ibirunke Akinshete.
On behalf of Sickle Cell Foundation Nigeria, we present this to you for all the contributions you have made in hematology, in every aspect of sickle cell disorder in this country, every area that you have contributed immensely to the needy. Is it HIV, AIDS? Name it. God will bless you. Thank you so much.
We're going to recognize very kindly our eloquent speakers, our erudite speakers for today. Professor Edamison Temiye, please. Edamison, right? Professor Edamison Temiye. I'm from Ondo. In appreciation of your extraordinary contributions to the sickle cell cause. And I'll very humbly request my aunt, Mrs. Gladys Talabi, to kindly present this award. Thank you.
On behalf of the Sickle Cell Foundation of Nigeria, I present this to you in appreciation of your extraordinary contribution to the sickle cell cause.
Continued appreciation for all and all you have shared with us today. You have made us, you have enlightened us further. My very own professor, Professor Titilokwe Adeyemo, our very own Professor Titilokwe Adeyemo. Thank you very much. This is an appreciation of your extraordinary contributions to the sickle cell Pulse. I will present this myself.
Continue to work hard to improve the quality of life of people living with sickle cell disorder with this award. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much. Okay, the last but not the least, this award goes to Miss Toyin Adeshola, T for Toyin, in appreciation of your extraordinary contributions to the sickle cell cause. The irrepressible Toyin Adeshola. Mrs. Okay, Abiola Gumbi has just come. Please kindly present this award to Toyin Adeshola, in appreciation of her contributions, extraordinary contributions, to the sickle cell cause.
Mr. Utoyi, it is with a great pleasure that I give this to you, Utoyi, for your mindset, for your encouragement, for all you do, and just being the warrior. Being the warrior and encouraging others. You encourage us all. Thank you, and keep going. And you know, those birthdays, keep, make sure they keep coming. Those birthdays must keep coming. Thank you.
I'd like to thank everybody. This award is not just for me, it's for every sickle cell warrior in this space and out there. I dedicated this to Sickle Cell Warriors of Sickle Cell Advocacy and Management Initiative, because they are the reason why I am here. No other reason. And of course, God. Because without God, oh boy, things would be hard. That's why I encourage everybody, stay strong and stay in faith.
Thank you very much, Toyin. Thank you, Mr. Gumbi. So, Director of Programs, Director of Ceremonies, right?
Thank you very much. You're very much welcome. Please appreciate Dr. Akinshete. Thank you. Thank you so much. I would like to invite to share the communique and vote of thanks, Mrs. Abiola Gumbi, your director within the Sickle Cell Foundation Nigeria. Afterwards, we will take the national anthem and we will round off with this wonderful event. Thank you so much, Ms. Ogunbi.
Good afternoon. Where do we start from now? What a beautiful day. We're standing, sitting, running, being, adopting, agreeing on the protocols, and we thank God for a day like this. Indeed, it's been such a journey. And but you see, when you get to a point where the journey is now that sickle cell is not a death sentence, then you're very pleased. I know there's been declaration of age today. Some of you are aware that I'm usually here. I've been on this journey for 30 something years, and it. It's interesting. But I think we need to send a quick message to our president. First, the media, please. First, we will not be going to court. We won't go to court. But we shall be reading, bringing hope. Hope. We've used that word. It's ours, isn't it? Hope. So renewed hope that our president has adopted. We shall be expecting sustainable funding. Our president Tinubu, we shall be expecting sustainable funding in lieu of a court matter for the use of the word hope. So we're bringing hope to the African child. So we're both using hope, and we're going to be doing the work on behalf of all of us. And in our conclusion, as I read the communique, one thing we've recognized is this journey is not for the 25% impacted. It's not for the 25% of Nigerians who are carriers or sicklers. This journey is for every Nigerian, 100%. So the involvement of non-directly impacted Nigerians and friends of Nigerians is required on this journey. So I will read the communique from the activities of today. But I'll just quickly say in Yoruba, because I noticed in Kotafe Sheleni, Tafe Soleni, Nikwe, Bogowa Nigerians. Nani konshe, nani konshe. Konshe fan won ti won kon la won mo. Ti won ni sikla, abi ti won ni eje, to ni AS, otio. Gogo wa la ma so wopo, la ma se. And then, won tu so pe, ijoba wa, won ti ni nkan ti won gbe wa ni pe, ki gogo wa ni hope. Ireti, ireti. I want to lo ati lo nsi o ti dodun melo so ijoba wa owo wa ni won ti gba o so won ma san we owo ta fe ki won so fun ti won fi lo ireti yen ni pe won ma fi owo sinu ba se ma ri pe solution a ri gogo nkan ta ni ti se anito fun gogo nkan ta fe so I ma so fun awon ijoba wa ni yen I ma so fun president wa so gogo wa a ma fo oko a ma se e se o. So, mark our public lecture, Nisi. All protocol duly observed. A hybrid event held at the Multi-Purpose Hall, National Sickle Cell Center, Sickle Cell Foundation, Nigeria, SCFN, was live-streamed via Zoom, Facebook, and YouTube links. We were pleased to have with us the esteemed presence of Olorogun Dr. Sonny Kuku, OFR, as the chairman of the occasion, Professor Ibironke Akinsete as our guest of honor, whilst appreciating the very professional engagement of the Director of Ceremonies, Pastor Abiodun Famojuro. Having received goodwill messages from founder and past chairman of Sickle Cell Foundation Nigeria, Professor Olu Akinyoju, who emphasized that the sickle cell disorder is not something you hide from, and stress the importance of keeping the positive values of living above the myths around persons living with sickle cell. He went on to introduce one of the testifiers living with sickle cell, and she obviously testified, and we're very proud of her, looking very well. The chairman of the occasion, Olorogun Dr. Sonny Kuku, emphasized that sickle cell as it is today is not a death sentence as it was during his childhood. Pfizer Medical Director, ably represented by Dr. Chioma George, iterated that sickle cell disorder is not a death sentence, given that approximately 4 to 6 million people live with the disorder in Nigeria. She noted that the high mortality rate is prevalent among infants born with a disorder. To this end, Pfizer has partnered with Sickle Cell Foundation Nigeria for many years to provide their own support to persons living with sickle cell disorder. The able representative of the World Health Organization, Dr. Maimouna Essan, reiterated that sickle cell disorder is not a death sentence, and this is because there has been massive improvement in the overall impact of the sickle cell disorder in children. At WHO, she assured that they are committed to member states in providing, amongst others, effective clinical diagnosis, newborn screening, genetic counseling, and overall access to healthcare, all of which should be published via raising adequate awareness, and will add enlightenment. Able representative of Global Action Network for Sickle Cell and Other Inherited Blood Diseases, GAINSID, Mrs. Lanre Ajayi, noted the advocacy for sickle cell eradicated through a unified and well-coordinated efforts in the management of sickle cell disorder. More so, equitable access to healthcare is a key step to achieving the adequate management. First Lady of Lagos State, represented by Mrs. O.J. Olunuga, Medical Director of Ebutemeta General Hospital, praised the efforts of the Sickle Cell Foundation Nigeria for setting the public lecture for the purpose of awareness, which is key to eradicating and alleviating the impact of sickle cell disorder. She alluded to the themes agenda of the Lagos State Government on health in ramping up the efficiency of the general hospitals across the state in ensuring that access to health care for persons living with SCD. The CMD of LUTH, that's the Chief Medical Director, represented by the Chairman Medical Advisory Committee, CMAC, Dr. Oshodi, presented the very fruitful collaboration of LUTH and the Sickle Cell Foundation Nigeria, ranging from clinical diagnosis and laboratory investigations, as well as the state of the art bone marrow transplantation unit recently set up with the collaborative efforts of Lagos State Government and Vanderbilt University, USA. The Permanent Secretary of the Federal Ministry of Health, represented by Dr. Deborah Odo, Director of Non-Communicable Disease, emphasized the contributions of Sickle Cell Foundation to the cause of sickle cell disorder through newborn screening, amongst others. She reiterated the commitment of the Federal Ministry of Health by strengthening the 6 centers of excellence in the management of non-communicable diseases, including the sickle cell disorder. Our guest of honor, Professor Ibirunke Akishete, appreciated the Sickle Cell Foundation having sustained a world-class national center in order to drive research, making innovations that has benefited many patients and families. And today, it can be said, the sickle cell is not a death sentence. With the advances in the management of sickle cell disorder, is the bone marrow transplantation, as well as gene therapy, which does not require transplantation. Professor Akishete noted that one area that has not received enough attention in Nigeria is the modern comprehensive care, as this will drive the development of a holistic approach to the management of sickle cell disorder, requiring both a medical and non-medical team. There is also an urgent need for concerted efforts of both federal and state governments, as well as international agencies, to come up with a strategic plan for the management of sickle cell disorder, as well as financing, as no one entity can do this alone. This initiative, she further stated, depends on all stakeholders to take action, and the time is now. She reiterated the call to the government at the federal and state levels to allot a more appreciable percentage of the budget that could help to create a comprehensive healthcare for those living with sickle cell disorder. We then went on to the presentation of the papers, and this has been summarized as follows. Advances in management of sickle cell disorder was delivered by Professor Edamisa Temiye. He itemized blood transfusion, hydroxyurea, and bone marrow transplantation. He stated that the transcranial Doppler scan for stroke screening started in the Sickle Cell Foundation for the first time. He provided insights into research breakthroughs in diets such as Cajanus Cajun that have proven to contain abundant glutamine, alanine, and phenylalanine. I apologize, I'm simply a lawyer. With comparable effects on sickle cell disorder with hydroxyurea. He alluded to gene therapy as yet another advancement in the curative approach to SCD. However, it is accessible to only a few individuals with high income and very limited in low-income countries. He, however, assured that there is the possibility of definite cure for SCD through the technological improvement in gene editing tools and stem cell harvesting, as well as promising clinical trials. We then went on to the second presenter on the importance of early and accurate diagnosis of sickle cell disorder, Professor Titilope Adeyemo. She iterated that one of the early diagnoses of SCD is to take a preventive approach of annual stroke screening between the ages of 2 and 5. More so, at the 8th and 9th month of life, the kidney already shows signs of dysfunction, sickle nephropathy. Since SCD is a lifelong disorder, it therefore requires lifelong comprehensive care. She identified the associated risk factors, such as recurrent acute chest syndrome, vaso-occlusive episodes, as well as severe anemia, while the protective factors have been found to be induction of fetal hemoglobin by hydroxyurea. Professor Adeyemo noted the need for early diagnosis, which hitherto has been missed at different stages of life, including preschool, pre-employment, premarital, prenatal, community screening outreaches, as well as newborn and infant screening program. There is yet the problem of misdiagnosis and genotype misidentification, which have been very rampant as a result of lack of standards and quality control. In closing, she recommended continued advocacy for the National Universal Newborn Screening Program, more so, engage. Hello.
Oh, okay, great. Fantastic.
In closing, she recommended continued advocacy for the National Universal Newborn Screening Program. More so, engaging regulatory bodies to ensure laboratories are taking all steps to eliminate / minimize systematic errors by routinely calibrating equipment, using controls, maintaining instruments and equipment, and comparing values against standards and training and retraining lab staff. It is possible, as she concluded, it is possible to live full lives and enjoy most of the activities that other people do. There is only the need to learn how to stay as healthy as possible, and that starts with early and accurate diagnosis of the disorder, followed by being enrolled in a sickle cell disorder care program. Surviving and thriving was what our testifiers emphasized. They emphasized the positive mindset, tailored with conquering in the face of health challenges, underlined the advocacy for better health care and support, build a support network of family, friends, and healthcare professionals who will help to rise above the physical and emotional effects of the sickle cell disorder. In conclusion, the World Sickle Cell Day is appreciated. It creates a window to bring to the fore the need for enlightenment, advocacy, collaboration at public and private sectors across the nation and sickle cell impacted societies. There's a need for us, and here we talk about not just the government and the management and service providers and NGOs, but every Nigerian to take ownership of where we are with sickle cell disorder so that we can, with inclusive collaboration, develop a workable strategy, policy formulation, planning and implementation with emphasis on modern comprehensive care and research. Finally, we need to recognize the cost of stigma and do all we can to avoid its influence in our society and in the solutions to be adopted. The foundation is happy and committed to lead with the requisite sustainable funding in place. And that rounds up the communique. The director of ceremonies has told me to pick up my books and just step aside. But I'm not sure we will do that without at least saying thank you. You know, so please permit me to, you know, as quickly as I can, to thank. Obviously, we will thank, as we have also thanked at the we'll thank the members of the high table, our chairman, our guest of honor, our national director, Professor Lu Femi Akinyoju. We thank you very much, as always. We are indebted to your bringing us here. We thank Olorogun Sonikuku. We felt your presence through the years, advisory and also resource-wide. We thank you for stepping up always to be at this event. and to also support us in all ways. We know we do call upon you. Professor Akishete, thank you very much, ma. I thank you for your presence today. I also thank you from the 35%. I always like to do that when I see the women. I thank you very much for being a great ambassador. Thank you, ma. Thank you for the efforts in blood transfusion. I do know an organization that donated blood last week, so that's being sustainable. Eshema, thank you very much. I would like to thank, obviously, Chief Medical Director of Luth, Professor Adeyemo. I'd like to thank the CEO of Medical Science Council of Nigeria. I'd like to thank Professor Titilayo Adeyemo. I'd like to thank Dr. Rotimi Abola Gorite. I'd like to thank Dr. Shegun Ogboye. I'd like to thank Mrs. Chioma George. I'd like to thank Dr. Abosede Wellington. I would also like to thank, sorry, I'm not putting the, you know, because of time. I mean, he's literally, you know, Dr. Deborah Odo. I'd like to thank Engineer Olufunso Adebiyi. We'll also be thanking, you know, we need to thank our chairman of the board of the sickle cell, Chief Tunde Afolabi, MFR. He's not here today, but I know that his heart is here, and he's not here because he's had to take care of certain family issues. But we thank him for his effort. Professor Edami San Temiye, thank you, sir. And Toying Adeshola, thank you. We also, of course, thank Mrs. Mudupe. In fact, Mrs. Popola, we don't thank you, one of us, but we do thank you very much for being here as well and for testifying. We do have a long list of sponsors to thank. And we will thank Pfizer. And we thank Dr. George very much for her efforts and for their renewed and constant commitment to the cause and for being the sponsors of today's event. Other sponsors of our World Sickle Cell Day event are Templars, La Roche Leadership Foundation, ShopRite, Macfelle, Chicken Republic, Indomie Noodles, Bobo Foods, Emergency Response Africa, DCL Laboratories Products Limited, Codex, Bond Chemical, Concurrent Technologies, Luth, Lagos State Government, Zwack Kukri, our media partners, our ever faithful and supportive media partners, in no order of preference, you know, but we will start channels, Arise News, AIT, LTV, TVC, The Nation, The Guardian, Nigerian Tribune, STV, Echo FM, Daily Sun, News Agency of Nigeria, Punch Newspaper, and word of mouth. So I thank everyone here and online who are also word of mouth advocates, and for the warriors who continue to thrive and carry on, and for all those who continue to stand by, and the 75% who may not necessarily be directly impacted, but are our brother's keepers. And I noticed online some time ago that there was a reminder to the biblical phrase that we should love God and love our neighbors. And no better way do we exemplify and experience this than being in support of efforts like this. And just a reminder to our donors, which is a point that I think sometimes we keep forgetting, is that we do have tax exempt status, which means that your donations to us will be recorded and you'd pay less tax. So please take that out as you champion this cause on behalf of all of us. Thank you very much. And National Director, management, staff, the cleaners, and all those who put this together, thank you very, very much.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Ogunbiyi. Eshegidigoni, Eindadiwati, Momiwa. Immediately after now, we're going to take the national anthem. Refreshment has been provided for us, so there's refreshment. We have some exhibitors within the foyer. We'd like you to just look at what they've brought, and the ones that you can acquire, please connect with those.
I just wanted to note, I hope you knew that I thanked you at the very beginning. Yeah, I just so that people recognize that he was thanked at the very beginning.
Thank you for thanking me. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. Shall we rise for the national anthem of the Federal Republic of Nigeria? The Art and Medicine Orchestra. Thank you very much, everyone. See you at the next World Sickle Cell Foundation Day, Sickle Cell Day next year. Refreshment has been provided. As you step out, you will be taken care of. Thank you so much.
No one can, no one will.